Good evening. Welcome. I'm Kate Goldstein Breyer, and on behalf of City Arts and Lectures, I'd like to welcome you. We are so excited to be partnering with the New York Times on this program tonight. It's a really special one. It's a bit of a homecoming for our guests. I think you know who they are. Wesley Morris, Jenna Wortham. They're going to talk to us about something you may have heard, a podcast called Still Processing. And they'll take some of your questions at the end of their conversation. So without further ado, Still Processing's Wesley Morris and Jenna Wortham. I felt the world
I'm Wesley Morris.
I'm Jenna Wortham. And this is, what is this? Still Processing Live from San Francisco. Thank you guys for coming out tonight. We really appreciate
you.
It. We know that SF is kind of a sundown town, so like we appreciate y'all staying out on these streets. For us, it's deep. Sorry. We're coming in hot.
Speaking of which, do you just want
to Okay.
I'm going to clear the air just right off the bat. Just do it.
Okay.
Cuz if you don't do it, I will do it.
No, just I want to see where you're going to go. I'm just trusting you. Just trust falling right now.
We had a little bite to eat before we came in here today.
And we're not going to name names, but two folks in here, Sita and Taylor, y'all got the receipts because you saw us at the restaurant. But we're not going to name the restaurant, but some people in here know where we were.
And I will just say that they probably don't know.
Okay. All right, keep going.
There was a menu item, a special on the menu just for tonight. It was stamped with today's date.
So like, you know when you go to restaurants and they're like, here's the menu and here's today's menu. So we got the special insert.
And I'm gonna get the wording wrong, so you might have to help me with this.
But I'll help you.
It was a fried chicken dish.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a paragraph explaining
the origin
what
story.
Fried chicken was. I mean, look, there are all kinds of things I don't know. And if you tell me what they are, I'm just gonna read it and be like, I guess that's what it is. Except, you know, I know a little something about fried chicken. And this definition was a new one to me. It basically said...
It said, this is a traditionally Scottish dish that... Which, to be fair, okay, maybe true, has been popularized... As a cuisine of the American South.
No, not even popularized. Accepted.
Oh, accepted as.
Accepted as a cuisine of the American South. Now.
Again, not untrue, but I you're mean, taking a lot of liberties in getting to that truth.
Right, I just feel like there's so many, this is like the HOV lane to fried chicken.
Right, right. This is the Green Book version of fried chicken.
Oh my God.
But the thing that Wesley's not saying is I was a little late to our meeting because I got stuck in traffic, but we were meeting before we came in here. And as soon as I sat down, Wesley goes, Jenna, look at the menu. It was so funny.
This is a thing that happens a lot though, where like you, the place, I mean, I don't actually know how upset to feel about it, right? Because Because I, you know me, one of my problems as a human being is I will go as far out on the plank as I can to give somebody the benefit of the doubt. So I'm thinking, maybe this is something that the people who wrote this, the one person probably who told this story in this paragraph on this. Also, they made it seem like they were doing us a favor as as diners by sharing this story with us.
Yes.
It's just like, in case you didn't know, this very special dish you're about to eat, which is so different from the thing you can get from Popeyes down the street, and so much more expensive. You can get five Popeyes, what are the popcorn chickens? You can get like seven popcorn chickens for the price of this like heirloom Scottish fried chicken.
It was pretty incredible. I mean, it was actually really incredible, and I kind of loved it because I liked how the menu was kind of asserting, like, you think you know what fried chicken is. However, like, Wikipedia is wrong, okay? We're the real truth merchants. But anyway, it was interesting because, you know, coming back to San Francisco, this is a homecoming for both of us. We both have lived here. We didn't know each other when we lived here, slightly different periods of time, but you know, San Francisco is a second home. It definitely forged me in more ways than one. I will say, when I came back this trip, I was on my way to a meeting, and I just wandered into, like, a little boutique, and I was like, this looks cute. And it was, I kid you not, it was just, like, a place that sells all Burning Man clothes. And I was like, correct. This is my home. But,
What happened do you hear, would you say that no, I mean, like, because I was, like, my version of being back here, I mean, I come back here not infrequently. Mm-hmm. But I also, in coming on this particular trip, thinking about talking to you in front of you guys, I was thinking about how important this city was to my development as the person who's become this person. Mm. And I was wondering if there's a way in which San Francisco and the Bay Area especially has forged some aspect of you that is still there. Or maybe purged you of something that needed to go.
Interesting. I mean, I want to hear the same from you, because I'm very curious what fires the city lit under you. But I think for me, you know, I grew up in Virginia. I'm from Northern Virginia, and I went to school out there at the University of Virginia.
Ooh.
Some fans in the house.
Welcome.
All right. Well, they just won some sort of game.
Oh, yeah, okay, y'all.
Yes, okay. I was on a chat with numbers I had not saved about this said game, and I was like, okay, all right, something happened at UVA. That was positive for once, but... But, you know, for me, I grew up there, and I felt very constrained by being on the kind of exurb suburbs of Washington, D.C., and I think coming, you know, and UVA was high pressure. It was like, are you going to be a doctor? Are you going to be a lawyer? Are you going to study econ? And I was studying medicine because I didn't know. Nobody.
Wait, I'm sorry. What?
You don't see these on my face? What are you talking about? You didn't know I was like very pre-med and into...
No, we can get... Okay.
We've
no,
never had
I
this
did,
version of this
I did,
convo
I
before.
I did not know that.
Okay, well, we'd...
I swear to God, I did not know.
I don't know who you
what
are
What kind
sometimes.
Of doctor would you have been? I mean, you basically are a doctor now.
What am I a doctor of now?
Like, the spirit.
Oh.
I mean, yes. I'm just saying, but the thing is, the thing that I, when you say being a doctor, the thing I envision with your being a doctor is like having to wear scrubs. I just don't see you doing
no,
that.
No.
Now,
I would have been in a lab. I would have been in a crisp white coat.
Okay.
With like some cute shoes. You know what I mean? It would have been a look.
Can I just tell you, I feel like, you know, one of my friends is in the audience tonight, one of my dear friends who is also a doctor and really makes an effort to look nice at work, and I feel like I don't know. I'm just trying to imagine you doing that labor every day. I just don't see
I
you
do
doing
all
it.
Kinds of labor every day. I, trust me.
Anyways.
Whether or not I'm in a hospital.
UVA.
So I graduated. I was burnt out and loaded up all my possessions into a car with my partner at the time. And we just road tripped it. Like, we road tripped it, you know. And there were no, like, we didn't have GPS, y'all. So we were looking at a map. Like, I guess we're going this way today. And then we got here eventually, and a couple of my really good friends from college came out, and you know, I'd been working as a waitress in college, and so I came here, you know, did the exact same thing. I worked at a place called Saha in the Tenderloin that's embedded in a hotel. And it was funny because the TL back then is not the TL of today, or maybe it is. I didn't actually cruise by there this trip, but it was funny because I would get picked up from work, and it would always be like the engine was still on, and I had to jump in as the car was moving because people were like, we don't want to get picked up for solicitation, and I was just like, it's not that deep. And then I would look over in the lamp pole, there'd be some ladies of the evening like doing laps around the pole, and I'd be like, okay, true, all right, I do work in a, all right. And then I worked around the corner from here in Hayes Valley at a restaurant called Sauce that's been relocated, but that was like, hopefully some of the crew is in the house tonight, but that was like my home the whole time I lived here until I started working as an intern at Wired and basically any place that would have me. I worked out till I came to the Times, but I think California for me always represented just like a place to really kind of expand and get larger and really like, I don't know, I like made a lot of my own clothes during that period of time. I lived off of the Golden Gate Park, and like there were always like people stumbling out of the park like covered in glitter and like half clothes on a Monday. And I would be like, yes. And sometimes I was that person. And I think for me, you know, it was just, you know, we talk about microdosing now as like a thing, but back then we just called it Tuesday, you know, so I was just really out here learning some things about myself, and I feel like I needed the space and freedom from the East Coast to sort of really lean into my more emotional self and get a little bit away from my intellectual self, you know what I'm saying? So for me, it was just, you know, I feel like I come back here and I understand like everything about myself. I'm staying near Ocean Beach, and it's so verdant over there, and like Jurassic Park, you know, and I'm like, I was like spending a lot of time in this patch of succulents the other day, and I was just like, this is the real me. This is the real me. And I was very happy to say, I went through a walk, I went on a walk through the Castro, and I was very happy to see that all the places, like I was like, damn, yes. That bar I got kicked out of that time for taking my shirt off is still there. Or like, yes, the Mint one time, you told me I could not sing Tyrone by Erykah Badu, and I slapped a pint glass off the bar, and I haven't been back since. The Mint is still there. Like, it was just like walking through lane.
Which karaoke queen told you you could not sing Tyrone?
I don't remember the KJ, but it was so funny because they kept being like, I got you, and then not playing it. And I was like, it took me a while to figure out. I was like, the jig is up. Like, play this song. They never did.
You under-tipped that person.
I was tipping the whole time. Listen, don't talk to me about tipping. I lived on tips in this damn town the whole till I moved to New York.
All right, well, we'll table that.
I know. So what about you, sir?
I came here in 1999, which was, I think, one of the times to be in San Francisco just to say, like, well, something changed. And I was probably the same age you were. I was maybe 22?
Babies.
And I came out here to work at the Examiner, which was owned by the Hearst Company, and they bought the Chronicle and then merged the staffs. And I was a film critic at the age of 22 years old. And I know. Thank you. That should not have happened. I mean, I'm really glad that it did.
We're so lucky that it did.
I thank Sharon Rosenhaus, who was the managing editor of the San Francisco Examiner at the time, and Phil Bronstein, and everybody. I mean, you know, I had a ton of people at that newspaper who, like, looked out for me and took care of me and made me a better writer. But I didn't know anything about the world when I got here. This was the place where I feel like I grew up. And I had never really had alcohol as an adult. I had never really had proper sex as an adult. Because I was barely an adult, but whatever. I mean, I had never done any of these things in what I would classify as being the right way. I had never, like...
I know.
I will just say that, like, I did them all right here.
Oh.
And
all kinds of ways.
And I don't know. I was stupid to leave, I think. You know, because what I have a lot of fondness for the moment where I decided that I was just going to leave.
Mm.
And I was going to just move to New York because, damn it, I'm good enough. That was my thinking.
Did you have a job offer, or you were just like, it's time to check out?
I didn't have anything.
Going back east, okay.
I was a young, foolish person who was like, it'll work out. I really thought that. Despite all of the, what I would say are fairly ostensible odds against me just walking into a job in New York, I did have some things set up, but I left on August, I left at the beginning of the U.S. Open of 2001.
That's so specific.
Oh, I mean, I'll never forget the day I left. It was like a Monday.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the first, it was like day one of the U.S. Open of 2001. That was the tournament where Leighton Hewitt, for anybody who cares about this sort of thing, that was the tournament, that was the year where Leighton Hewitt was playing James Blake, and he got a bad call, and Leighton Hewitt, you know, Rusty Hewitt, says to the chair umpire, this is before Serena. Now, when we give Serena a hard time, we suddenly forget all of this crazy stuff that happened in any tennis match before Serena Williams did it. But Leighton Hewitt was like, I got a bad call. What do you think is the similarity between this line judge and this Negro over here, James Blake?
Mm.
And just, I don't, now correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think he got fined. I think some people, anyway, I remember that tournament very well. I had just gotten to New York. And that was, you know, almost a month later, or less than a month later, September 11th happens.
Oh, wow.
So, I mean, it kind of, I instantly just wanted to come back to San Francisco.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I also wanted to, I felt like I wasn't done growing here. So I do feel like I stopped something that was happening to and for me to roll the dice on something that I didn't know what I was rolling the dice on.
It's actually interesting because when I left San Francisco, I had gotten hired by the New York Times to come be a blogger, as we called them back then. And
what do we call them now?
Like, I was going to say something unkind, but you know, not that anymore. But it was interesting because my leave story was really specific too. So I got the job offer from the New York Times. I turned 25. Barack Obama won the election, and my good friend Tarvat, who's here, like pulled me into the knockout. We jumped in the photo booth, and she was like, "You're gonna want to remember this moment." And it was just like I remember the streets were flooded with everybody celebrating that election. And then I left a day or two later.
That's really interesting because I went to New York from here, thinking that I was gonna get a job at the New York Times, and I did not get that job. And it's funny because I didn't get it, and this woman named Sheila Rule,
mm-hmm.
who you might remember, you don't remember her?
Mm-mm.
She was in the HR department, and she was a writer for the paper for a while. I just found out she was in that sex episode, the marriage issue with the New York Magazine.
Yeah.
I was like, where's Sheila Rule been all this time? She married a dude who's in prison, and they are happily married together, and there was a whole little profile on them in New York Magazine. It's like, Sheila! Sheila was so good to me. I mean, there's a picture of her in bed with this dude.
We edit out all of this. So you're just getting the raw, unfiltered. That's why I'm just not even flinching, because this is every day for me. I'm just like, where are we going? I don't know. Neither do you, and he doesn't either, and we're just gonna ride the train till it gets to the next station. This is my life.
Anyway, Sheila is doing okay.
Well,
I did not get the job at the New York Times
because
there was no job for me to have or even ask about. But Sheila Rule took me to a bunch of meetings. She took me to one important meal and said, listen, I don't know what's going to happen to you, but I wish you luck, and I think you're probably going to be okay.
Aww, and Sheila. I love that.
I was like, I'll never forget that you said that, even if it's not okay, because it'll make me feel like no matter what I'm doing, which for about a year was working at a video store.
Which is my favorite detail about you, that you were an usher in a movie theater and then you worked in a video store. It's just like...
I did.
It's so perfect.
And it was... I worked at a Kim's Video in New York City, which for anybody who knows... Mm-mm. See, you're clapping, but I wasn't at that Kim's. I was at the Columbia Kim's that the dudes downtown were like, ugh, those nerds up at the Columbia Kim's. What a bunch of losers. But wow. Anyway, I had a great time. It changed my life. But well, the sort of fast forward version of this is we both wound up in the same place.
Yes, at the same time.
At the same time.
And what a lot of people don't know is that we didn't really know each other before we started working together on the podcast. Like, we knew who the other one was, and we would interact.
We have two funny, which funny before we met stories do you want to tell?
I only know of one, so I don't know which one you're talking about. But
you know there are two.
I feel like there's one.
One was a phone call.
Oh, okay. Let me tell the phone call one.
One was the party.
Okay, I want to tell the phone call one because it makes you look good, and then you should tell the party one because it makes me look good.
Done.
Okay, so when I started at the New York Times, I was just a little wee reporter, and so, you know, you're literally kind of in a type of bullpen, and they just throw you assignments, and you kind of have to take them on. And one thing that they do every year is whenever it's time for the Pulitzers to be announced, they round up a bunch of young reporters, and you write the blurbs of all the winners at the paper, and then, you know, just across all the papers that go up on the site as the day progresses. And I was assigned five people to call, and one of the names on the list was Mr. Wesley Morris. So I dial the number, and you're kind of like, you know, it's the most important day of a journalist, you know, it's just the most important day for a journalist, and so you don't expect to get them. So I'm like eating a sandwich, dialing these calls, I'm just like already writing them up, like whatever. And I go through the list, and I call the number that they have for Wesley, and the voice, I think it's still the same voice message, actually. I think it's still the same voice at the end. But so the voice message comes on, he's like, hello, this is Wesley. And I was like this, oh, we got a brother up in here. I was like, oh. So I was like spit out my sandwich, and I was like, bleh. And I was like, hello, Mr. Wesley Morris. My name is Jenna Wortham, and I am a reporter for the New York Times. Congratulations on your win. I would love to know how you're feeling today in this moment, in this time. Give me a call back, 212-556, whatever. I'm like, he's not gonna call me. So I write the thing, I send it away to publish. And then I just dip out, because I'm like, nobody is getting back to me. So I just go for a walk or go get another sandwich, I don't know. Knowing me, it was another sandwich. So I come back to my desk, and I'm like, oh, the light's blinking, and I listen. And now knowing Wesley, it makes perfect sense. But the message is like, hi, Jenna. Well, so I was walking to pick my laundry, and I got your message. And so I just wanted to tell you, you never think these kinds of things are going to happen. And then they do. And by the way, oh, hi, Mary. Mary, yes, I know I'm on my way. I'm so excited. Thank you. And it just goes on. And I'm just, I don't know. I feel like being a young cub reporter is like, you're just picking up the scraps. And so sometimes when you get like a really nice, you know, scrap, you're just so unbelievably grateful. And I just couldn't believe that he would take the time. He was the only person to call me back of all the people that I had to go through that day. And I remember going to my editor and being like, we got to put some of this in. He's the only person that called back. And it really moved me. And I think you just, you know, I was a fact checker for a long time. I was an intern. I worked in a restaurant. Like, you just notice when people are kind, and you notice when people treat you like a person and treat you like a human and not like a service worker. And so, which there's nothing wrong with being, but I'm just saying, it's like people are, they get really used to treating you like you're just there to kind of do the maintenance. But it really moved me, and it always left an impression on me. And so when you came to work at the Times, I was just like really pleased. And I was like, this guy, he's a good one. He's going to be a good one. So, you know, there you have it. Raised right.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, my version, my story, it's
several
not even a version.
Several years
later. Was when I was at Grantland, I got invited to a party. Yeah, I know. Me too. I got invited to a party. I don't know if if Charles Duhigg invited me or Rembert Brown invited me. But they were both there.
Mm-hmm.
And at some point, I was talking to Rembert, and Rembert was about to, like, go sit at this table. And I noticed there was, like, there were just people at the table, and I had just moved to New York at this point, and I just didn't know anybody. I didn't really know anybody at this party, but it was one of those New York media parties where if you even a little bit converse in New York media, you're just kind of like, oh, it's people from the All, and some people from Gawker, and I don't belong here. And I looked over at one table, and there was this woman holding court. It was like a high top table, woman holding court. I remember what you were wearing. Like, you were wearing a leather jacket, and everybody at that table was just completely transfixed. And I said to Rembert, Rembert was like, I'm gonna go talk to Jenna. You know Jenna, right? And I was like, I do. And I was actually terrified to go sit at that table. And he's like, what is wrong with you? Why are you acting like this? And I'm like, this vibe from this table, it does not want me there. And
that's not true.
It wasn't you.
Okay.
It was the people around you who were just like, they just were wrapped by your being. And you were talking, like you were actually telling a story. So I went and I sat down. My memory of this is that I sat down at this table, and I was expecting to be totally ignored, and suddenly the person, like Jenna, did not want to talk to anybody else at the table. She only wanted to say hi to me.
He was in a tuxedo. I just want to put that out there. I just want you to know, the sun was still up. We were at a bar in Brooklyn, like, and not even, I mean, it was, it's like the, if you know Brooklyn, it's the Bell House, so it's like Gowanus, which is on a toxic river. So it's just like, it's a part of Brooklyn that, like, we were only there for this party. So I was just like, who the hell is up at this damn house in a tuxedo? But I also knew it was you, and I was actually, like, eyeing you the whole time, and I was trying to will you closer, like, it's my Scorpio magnetism. So I kept being like, come to me. Like, I was just, like, drawing you in.
I definitely went.
It was really wonderful.
So at the paper, at some point, I mean, it's funny because there's a story about how, there's an untrue story or an exaggerated story about how the podcast came to be.
The untrue story is also the true story, though, because every time you tell the story, I'm like, that's just the truth.
But no. The truth is that when I started this job, I very innocently but affirmatively said, it would be great if one of the things that I do while I'm here is have a podcast. Now, when I got this job, that was I didn't know the trail of tears of other people who had said the same thing and just got sent back to their desk. I didn't understand the hubris with which I was making this request. I just had a podcast. The damn company went out of business, and I wanted to do another show. It did not seem like a hard thing. Also, I was looking at what the New York Times was doing, and they had three podcasts.
Right.
It didn't seem like a heavy lift. Grantland had like 16.
Right.
And one person made all of them.
So you're saying it's
it just didn't seem like a big deal to have a podcast.
You made a very gentle request that you'd like to have a podcast, and then on the flip side of it, it was like people were like, it was like there was like a montage of like handkerchiefs flying, and they're like, Wesley Morris wants a podcast, like sweeping, like we got to make it happen if he's gonna come. It's like a waiter carrying like a million plates, like juggling. Okay.
Actually, like,
yeah,
that is actually true, but
this is what I
but.
Witnesses, receipts, here. This is what I'm always saying.
But what I'm saying is, it just didn't seem like a big request. Like, I don't have a real sense of, I understand now because, you know, as listeners, you guys, I mean, as people who know, podcasting between 2015 when I started at the New York Times and now, and in 2015, like, a podcast was a regular part of a lot of people's diets. But it wasn't anything like
That's
it
true.
Is, you know, like it was even a year later.
Mm.
And the idea now that, like, I would just walk into what now would be a woman named Lisa Tobin's office and be like, yo, Lisa, guess what? get in the show. When did it start? I mean, but that's a thing that, like, I this happened for me at the exact right moment. And so basically what I said I wanted was, I just want to do a show like the show I had with Alex Papademos called Do You Like Prince Movies? Mm-hmm. He and I would just sit around. We'd talk about popular culture. We'd be friends with each other on the show. There was no real editing. Sometimes the show would be 35 minutes. Sometimes it would be 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's crazy.
I was. They were like, well, who would you want to do that with? And I was like, Jenna Wortham. Mm. That was my first choice. And, you know, we had never, I mean, we had had some conversations at that point because we were office mates and we both work at the New York Times Magazine together. We, you know, you and I and Nicole Hannah-Jones would sort of sit in like a whatever kind of circle you want to call it.
We would have a little meet cue to her desk every day. And knowing Nicole was like Henny O'Clock every day, she was always like, I see y'all, come over here and like bust, and we'd be like, we're working.
I never said I'm working.
Yeah.
But I just knew that you were the person that I wanted to talk to and like to get to know because we were so different. And I actually never knew what you were going to say. And I mean, I'm assuming that you couldn't always predict what I was going to say.
Very true.
And I think the ways in which we're different are really, really complementary. And I think the other thing about the show is I had very little ambition for it, right? It was supposed to be a very easy thing.
Yes.
That we go into the studio for like an hour or maybe at the most 90 minutes once a week. Mm-hmm. And we record an episode and go on with our lives.
And now we did that for a little while. And I'm just going to say we've improved upon our process. We've polished and fine-tuned what we do.
But, I mean, I think that's the difference between asking for a podcast, like asking for and getting a podcast in 2015 at the New York Times and basically doing exactly what I did then now.
Yeah.
It's just, I mean, the order of, the idea of what a quality good show is has sort of astronomically improved too. Not that every good show is an extremely well produced one, but I do think that having a vision for what you're doing counts for something. And I will say that when I was like Jenna Wortham should, I would love it if Jenna Wortham did a show with me. I had zero ambition for the show, and it's only through working with you and the people who we've worked with on the show that you and I have figured out what the episodes that we wound up doing for this last, the previous 12 episodes that just ended 2 weeks ago. I mean, I think, you know, those are 12 of the best episodes that we've done.
A lot shifted from the time we started making the show, though. Like you said, we started playing around in 2015, and for anyone who has been listening since then, send us your Venmo handles. We will send you money as a thank you for putting up with that. Those early years. But you know, we wanted to just make a show where we would like talk about B romance movies or whatever. We just wanted it to be like super lighthearted, and we thought it would just be a really fun place where we put the stuff that we didn't get to write about.
Mm-hmm.
But then the election happened.
I was going to ask do you think there was a turning point for what?
Okay. I do. I think that we started taking, I mean, all journalists and all critics and all people who work in media, I think, started taking their jobs. It's not that they took them necessarily more seriously, but it was like we had entered another ecosystem and gravity was different. And all of us, instead of like walking at like this, you know, gravity was like 120%, and we were like, oomph, like, oh, whoa. So we had to reevaluate what we were doing and why and for whom. And so, I mean, the podcast just became, it just became so much more responsive to what was happening. And I think instead of treating culture as kind of an extracurricular, it was like, well, the culture is actually forging and shaping who we are and why we're here. And we have to treat it like a hypertext to try to understand something about where we're all at emotionally, spiritually, physically, psychically.
Yeah.
So.
And I think that thinking about, I mean, because I would also say that election, that Donald Trump election episode was a turning point for us. Only in that, well, I mean, for any number of reasons. Mm-hmm. Number one is that we couldn't tell whether everybody was listening to the show in the building or nobody.
Oh, that's when we found out, yeah. Because we used to talk, yeah, we used to have really, so our secret name for the show was, we tried really, really, really hard to get the show called Cakes, and we would just like really diligently present it, and like, well, we're gonna call it Cakes, like Cakes, you know? And they'd be like, but you guys know that Cakes is slang
no,
for
wait,
like.
You should say exactly who said this to us. Who tried to tell us what a cake was?
Who tried to tell us what Cakes was?
Sam Dolnick.
Oh yeah, Sam Dolnick was like, according to UrbanDictionary.com, Cakes is also slang for like cakes. And we were like, duh, you know. And they were like, we're not gonna call the first like podcast from the New York Times newly revamped audio department Cakes, as in like butts. And we were like, ugh, mom, dad, you know.
That was exactly, we were both at this meeting just, and Sam Dolnick, for anybody who doesn't know, he basically, you know, he is of the Oxelsberger family.
Yeah. And oh, yeah.
He wasn't just some random dude. It's like,
he's like, this is my family's legacy you're talking about?
And I can remember sitting at that meeting being like,
we were really sad. We were really, really sad. But
and that
okay.
was the only time, it's the only time.
They said no.
It's the only time they said
no. That's the only time, it's true. It's the only time they've said no to us.
And it was the only time that I remember feeling a word that I would describe myself as feeling petulant.
Yeah.
And I'm glad we got it out of our system then.
Yes.
And I think that moment made me an adult, and I was like more of an adult. And I realized that if I'm just going to sit here and throw a temper tantrum over a name, I really got to get some moral clarity on myself, because this is going to be the least of it. Thinking about where this show has wound up this season and like what our goals were and how it's different from what we had previously been doing. Mm-hmm. There's a lot, almost every week there's something that we don't feel like we get to.
Yeah.
Even when we feel like we get to it.
Yeah.
And I feel like you and I were talking about, you would send me a text one day saying, you know, I feel like when we talked about liars and when we talked about reality, two different episodes, I felt like we missed something.
Yeah.
And
we thought it might be fun to air out some of the B-sides, some of the things that we didn't get to this past season. I mean, because so much happened also. That was the other thing, too. It's like we can't, you know, each episode would be like 130 minutes, not just like 30 or 40 minutes if we tried to cram everything in. But we thought it could be fun to come today and unwind a little bit, unfurl a little bit more on this topic of reality, because I think even for both of us coming back to San Francisco, for me it's been, I mean, I've been back several times, but it's been about 10 years since I lived here and longer for you, and sort of thinking about what it was like for us then, what it's like now, kind of noticing the discrepancy between those two realities and thinking about kind of the story that they tell.
Mm-hmm.
We were like, it could be really fun to think about all the other ways in which we realize that, you know, we're not always all living on the same, in the same dimension, necessarily.
Even when it's pretty clear what actually is happening. We decided to take that.
Yeah, yeah.
And we're going to play a game with you this evening. It's very simple.
And it's called, Whose Reality Is It Anyway?
But you caught me on the counter.
Wasn't me.
Saw me banging on the sofa.
Wasn't me.
I even had her in the shower.
Wasn't me.
She even caught me on camera.
Wasn't me.
She saw the marks on my shoulder.
Wasn't me.
Heard the words that I told her.
Okay.
Wasn't me.
Heard the screams getting louder.
Do you guys remember this song?
Or the, yes. And the video.
I mean, I'm just asking. Some people, well, you know, maybe this is their first time. So that song is fascinating. It's called It Wasn't Me.
And that's all Shaggy says, the whole song, by the way.
But by the way, right off the bat, the song is lying.
Yes.
Because when you buy the single, it's credited only to Shaggy.
And
all Shaggy is
singing, doing
is like, it wasn't me.
Yeah.
But Rick Rock is doing all the work.
Yes.
He's the person bearing his soul. I had sex with this lady on the floor. I had sex with her in the shower. Mm-hmm. My girlfriend caught me on camera. And all Shaggy, who is actually credited as performing the song, is saying,
"It wasn't me." Do you think there's like a hidden vinyl somewhere in someone's garage, just like waiting to be discovered by this man Rick? That's like, "It was me, doing all the work."
I mean, it's just right there, Shaggy. Like, it really isn't Shaggy. It's Rick Rock.
Yeah. So we have some audio. I mean, not audio. We just play the audio. We have some photo help to sort of usher us along in this game, and we've got a couple of examples that we'd like to use.
So basically, but how it's played is, the picture will come up, we'll kind of contextualize who the person is.
And why we chose this example.
And we will decide amongst ourselves, with a show of applause, whose reality is it anyway?
Is it theirs or...
or actual reality. Or no, maybe it should be what you said earlier, which is mm-hmm. like, whose reality would you actually prefer to live in?
Right. Do we want to live in their reality or not, basically?
Okay.
So it'll be the show of applause of whether or not we buy into their reality or not.
May we have the first slide, please?
Please. Thank you, Kim. Okay. So I just want to say really quickly, I gave Wesley the job of getting these pictures, and I'm actually like, okay, you're going to have to set us up for this one. Because it's good, but it could have been
Jenna?
A little bit better. I'm just saying.
There were three options.
I know, but anything other than this probably would have been good.
But look at that face. I mean, Amy Adams robbed of a sixth Oscar, by
I know,
the way.
She, I know. Well, she's
with all due respect to Regina King, I'm not trying to take Regina King's Oscar back.
But it's true that Amy Adams never gets her due. Always a bridesmaid.
Yeah.
Always
anyway.
A bridesmaid. Okay, so describe what's going on.
This is a still from Vice, starring Christian Bale as Vice President Dick Cheney. And, listen.
Just wait. You don't know where we're going yet.
And Amy Adams as Lynn Cheney. And this looks like a very tense moment, which is why I chose it. It seemed like it told a story. Anyway, the reason that we've picked this is...
Well, I mean, I think we want to talk about what happens when you let Hollywood determine what the truth is, when you outsource a version of reality. So I hadn't seen Vice because you kept telling me not to watch it. You were like, it's going to stress you out in the theaters. And I was like, fine. So I didn't watch it, but then I was on Delta on the way here, which is my favorite theater of all time. I love their in-flight entertainment. They had it, and I got very excited. And I did the thing where I kept writing you messages and sending them off, even though I knew they'd all send once I landed. And I was like, oh my God, Amy Adams is so good. Oh my God, Tyler Perry is Colin Powell is the best erotic / fic ever. Like, I was freaking out about this movie.
She is right about Tyler Perry, by the way. And about Amy Adams, but I agree that Tyler Perry's Colin Powell.
Yeah. But I also felt like...
This is when you know this movie's in trouble, by the way.
Right.
When
right.
I'm like having Colin Powell dreams.
Right.
Good ones.
When that's like, yeah. But I just kept thinking the whole time I was watching this film, I kept thinking to myself, like, I don't know who Adam McKay is. Like, what is your agenda? Like, in theory, I agree with you, right? Like, I'm not, I don't feel defensive over Dick Cheney. He can rot his health, he can rot in hell for all I care. But, like, I just don't know how I feel about this being the definitive version of a still very monumental period of time in American history that we're not done yet dealing with. And the film seemed to sort of wrap everything up in a tidy bow as though, well, this is what happened and we're all screwed and this is whose fault it is.
Right. So for anybody who hasn't seen this movie, I'm not ruining anything for you because you know what? You're still living in it.
Right.
But the movie's big dismount is this amazing montage of every terrible thing that's happened since 2001,
pretty
since
much.
September 11th.
Yeah.
And apparently it's all his fault. And it was so appalling to me that it's not even an argument, it's a vomit spew of indictment. Like, the movie, you spend 2 hours watching this one movie, and then mm-hmm. all of a sudden, it's like its bowels break loose, and all of a sudden, every terrible thing that's happened anywhere in the world is, oh, by the way, if we haven't convinced you how evil this guy is, here it is, he's responsible for all this stuff. And I was so mad about that.
Yeah.
Because
same.
That's not really how it worked. And if you're really going to argue this, and the movie does have an argument to make about this man that I did actually find somewhat persuasive.
Yes.
But I was not persuaded by the idea that, like, every catastrophe that's happened on Earth in the last 35 years is his fault.
Right.
And how dare you make me defend this person?
That's what I'm saying.
To myself.
That's what I'm saying. It was enraging. I was like, I don't want to feel cynical or sympathetic about this film, and yet I'm finding myself feeling like, Adam McKay, what's your agenda, though? Like, it was just, it was like this, and I think part of the reason we got into this problem in the first place is because there was an oversimplification of, like, international politics that led us to this dynamic to begin with.
Yeah, I resent anybody who sends me home feeling like I need to call Tucker Carlson and have a cry. And that's between the Colin Powell feelings that I had and the idea that I'm like, but Dick Cheney, he's not that bad.
Is he? Like, it was just like that feeling of like, I know, you know what I mean? Like, I remember when Christian Bale thanked Satan for his inspiration and I applauded, but now I'm like, I gotta do some research because did it really go down like that?
So I guess the question we would ask you guys is, would you rather live in Vice's reality in which Dick Cheney is responsible for all this more terrible stuff, or the actual more complex reality in which 5% of that is true? Vice?
The Vice is...
Vice, applause for Vice. All right.
Kind of.
Or applause for a complicated world in which lots of people do a lot of terrible things. Including this guy.
And we can't let Hollywood rewrite history.
Oh, what's the hissing? Did we leave an option out?
We need flashcards,
Okay.
Well, we can't leave the narrative of history, though, like, up to Hollywood. I mean, that's the ultimate takeaway
from
this.
Well, yes,
though.
I guess. Maybe that's the third option.
Yeah.
Duh.
Yeah.
Okay, next slide.
This is one of y'all's. I mean, this is an example of when everyone buys into the same problematic reality. You know, a lie is still a lie, even if we all agree on it. I mean,
it's true. I mean, but I need you to do me a favor. Because, I mean, I've confessed this to you before, and I will confess it again. I don't get this. I really don't. I do not understand. I am fascinated by people's fascination with this story, but I don't care about this. I really don't. I listened to the podcast.
You did your homework, yeah.
I did all my homework. I did not read the book, which apparently is fantastic.
That's great.
I'll get to that next, but I listened to the show. I watched the HBO documentary, and I mean, I get it. I know she did some bad stuff, but I also I would love a separate show that's about the people who believed her. That's fascinating to me. The fascination, I know it's part of the story.
But it also kind of seems like no one believed her, and everyone just kept being like, you know what I mean? Like, that also seems to be part of the problem.
Right, okay.
So you're saying you don't get the fascination with how this happened. You don't understand how Silicon Valley got Fire Festival. Okay, yeah. When actually that's exactly how it all works all the time, but.
So, I mean, I guess one question I would ask relative to Billy McFarlane and the Fire Festival is, do you think there's a difference between the way she was treated and he was treated? Now, obviously, there's a real criminal justice difference, because Jenna just told me tonight that she's basically down the street.
Listen. She is the new Kevin Bacon. Like, everyone out here has a story about Elizabeth Holmes via somebody else. The other day, somebody was like, I have a grainy photo of her taken through the bushes that somebody texted me. And I was just like, what is going on? What is going on out in these streets? It's been too long since I've been covering tech, y'all. Like, I don't know. I mean, I guess I have a couple of theories, and one of them is, I mean, I think when the movie The Social Network came out, it really glorified an era that we now all really hate and blame for almost everything that's going sideways in our lives. I mean, for you guys, it's to the cost of living. You know, your rental prices out here. And I think...
I mean, listen, not... I mean, I'm just going to say, like, not that mine are that much better, but...
No, but I'm just saying in general, yes. I think there's been a big tide change, a big sea change in terms of how... Like, I think there was a period of time in which it was just like, you know, the tech titans, the people that were making all these apps and services that we use, we were like, solutions was great. Yeah, there is an app for that. Hell yeah, I want that app, you know? And now I think there's a little bit of, like, secondary caution. It's like, well, wait a minute, what's it going to mean now that, you know, what is Uber Eats doing to the restaurant industry? What is something like Siri doing to the way that people treat other people? Like, mm-hmm. what does it mean to mm-hmm. now live in this world that honestly, walking around San Francisco the last couple days, I really have felt like I've been in a 3D AutoCAD model. Like, I'm just like, is this real? Like, I'm just always like... Am I on the street? Like, what's going on? It just feels like, I don't know, like a Play-Doh world. It's really interesting. But I feel like she is a really easy, again, it's a documentary that I watched, and I didn't expect to feel defensive of this character. And I had to be like, what is going on? You know, like, why do I feel all of a sudden like there is this kind of pile-on happening to this one person because they are so visible and they are so strange, and the fixation on kind of the dress code and the hair and the voice and all the discussions around the voice make me deeply, deeply, deeply uncomfortable because people adjust their voices for all kinds of reasons, and until we know why she did it, it makes me uncomfortable and feels sometimes a little transphobic to speculate on it because vocal training is a very real thing that people do to adjust how their gender presents to the world. But I also think that there is a desire to point to someone and be like, you are the reason everything else has gone to hell. And I'm not saying that because I think what she's done is morally reprehensible. And I was really appalled in a lot of the reporting of her company, Theranos. I imagine everybody here knows, but if you don't know, Theranos is a company that Elizabeth Holmes started and purported to have a type of technology that could do blood diagnostics much better and faster than the incumbents in the field, Quest Diagnostics being one of them. And if you've ever had to go into a Quest Diagnostics and give any type of bodily fluid sample, you understand why people were so excited that there might be a worthy rival, because it's horrible and disgusting. But everyone, all of her advisors, a lot of the people she brought into her team were just like, this is not possible. And she would just be like, I hear you, and I raise you $1 billion. And they would be like, no, it doesn't work that way. And she was like, but it does. You know, it was just like this whole, like, she kind of kept insisting the emperor had clothes, and people were like, it doesn't have clothes. And she took advantage, I think, of a system that really kind of places its trust in its entrepreneurs and its founders and the aesthetics of building a company, right? You build out a very esteemed board of directors and people on your team that offer a type of authenticity or validity by proximity. But in reality, the people on her board did not know what the hell she was doing either, you know, and she had all these people in her pocket, Tim Draper, who's a very well-known Valley investor, was a family friend, and then she had all the makings of the dropout, I mean, she had all the makings of the narrative that people have come to sort of take, again, as a proxy for some type of authenticity, because she was a dropout, she went to Stanford, she started her first company in 19, mm-hmm. She had all the makings of what we've come to expect of a type of class of people who are building the future, and she just kept getting these free passes. And I was really shocked that the documentary, people were just kind of like, yeah, I don't know, I hope my syphilis test is accurate, you know, and it was just like, wait, but people are taking these tests and yeah. don't actually know? Like, did anyone call the people, the 60% of people whose results were probably not true and let them know you might want to get retested? It's just like the ethics involved yeah. in this whole situation were really appalling.
See, I can listen to this all day.
Yeah, I know. We should have done an episode about it.
What I couldn't have listened to is, well, whatever. The shows are fine. But I do feel like people's relationship to this story are just more interesting to me than the story itself. So, Elizabeth Holmes, her reality, would you rather be there?
In the sense that basically fake it till you make it, even if you're putting hundreds, if not thousands of people at risk.
Way to put your fingers on the scales of that one, Jenna Wortham. Yeah, I'm going to clap for that now. Next slide.
So, I also want to say, I said, sir,
I can see it now.
It's not O.J. Smollett. Like, why did you pick that photo?
But, okay, so I'm the person who, if I saw that on, like, any news network, I'd be like, what the fuck is that? He didn't kill anybody. I did it. No pun intended.
It was you.
But if I did it, it just looked like, I mean, he's at least smiling. The glove just slipped.
You didn't think
me.
About it till just now, honey?
Not till you pointed it out. I am very disappointed in myself.
So why is this in the rotation? Tell the people.
Because, again, here is another person that I am conflictedly sympathetic toward. I know. So Jesse Smollett, for anyone who doesn't know, was in Chicago one frigid February evening, hungry, needed himself something to eat. Thank God for Subway.
Listen, because when you get home and you don't have no food in the house, did y'all see this interview? And he was like, listen, Robin, that's what Subway's for.
Okay.
It's open 24 hours. When you get home from a trip and you're hungry, you go to Subway. And she was just like, okay. Because the last time I checked, Chicago had Postmates, but okay. Anyway.
Listen, the thing about Subway is they pump that smell onto the street. And you just are like, maybe I do need that 6-inch sandwich.
Thank you. I wasn't gonna do it to you on stage, but I'm glad. I'm rubbing off on you. It's good.
So this young man goes to get his sandwich and experiences what, for about how many days? 3 or 4 days, was an absolutely shocking, heinous, disgusting, outrageous, upsetting attack. The men were allegedly, I mean, it's the details are somewhat in flux, but there was a Make America Great Again, aka MAGA something involved. They were wearing masks so he couldn't see them. There was bleach thrown on him. They called him the F word and the N word. He took himself to the hospital, and why don't you take over from here? Because now the details get fuzzy for me.
I mean, we still don't know.
Okay, well, why don't we just leave it at that?
We still don't really know what happened, and we're still trying to figure out, like, which version of events, you know, did he make everything up? Did the Chicago PD mess with all the evidence? I mean, it's just, like, it's completely unclear at the end of the day, like, who, what, where, when, why. Say that again 3 times because it's like this, like none of the details add up.
But the thing that is fascinating to me about this case is, even if he is lying, and I mean at this point we kind of know that at least the attack didn't happen the way he says it did. And yet we kind of don't really even know that.
We still don't even.
We still don't know.
Yeah.
And I think that the reason that this is so fascinating to me, and the reason I understand people's fascination with Elizabeth Holmes is, and the reason that I find Vice so appalling is because Vice doesn't trust us to be okay with not knowing everything.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And there's something about these other two cases that, like, there are just so many unanswered and potentially unanswerable questions. And
Well, I think this is also a really good example of what happens when you can't trust your justice system. You can't trust due process. You can't trust, like, a system like, this is the same city within which, you know, we had the Laquan McDonald case, which we talked about on our podcast.
Under the same circumstances.
Under the exact same circumstances. And so, you know, it's kind of the outcome of lots of other things. And I mean, we're not defending Jesse at all, because again, if you're invoking hundreds of years of racial terror and homophobic violence in order to do what? Get a Subway endorsement? I don't know. Like, it is, you deserve to be punished, you know? But I also think that it really exposed something fundamentally flawed. Like, we kind of all got ourselves in the same situation, because we can't trust the law to figure anything out, because they're as shady as he is. And so it's, I don't know, it's just an interesting dynamic in the trifecta that we have here of what happens when the reality is just.
Yeah, whose reality is it anyway? I don't even know if it's worth, I mean, again, we're not even gonna play this game with Jesse Smollett.
It's a very loosely a game,
right.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean.
But, I don't know.
All the answers are rigged, yeah.
It's really mm-hmm. fascinating to just think about the idea that this person, you know, what punishment fits this crime?
Yeah.
And
well, it also exposes something too about our obsession with the type of carceral justice. It's like people were calling for him to spend all of this time in jail, and it's just in prison. And it's just like, at the end of the day, like, do we really need more people going to prison? Like, it's just, we have this obsession also with like a very particular type of punishment.
Yeah, I'm really bad about punishments. I have no idea what an appropriate punishment is. Mm. You know, I'm somebody who grew up watching people go to prison mm-hmm. for nothing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
For like having, you know, like a plastic bag with some herbs in it mm-hmm. that weren't even weed. You know, I mean, and sometimes they didn't even have it on them. Mm. They were just, it was just discovered on their persons.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you're talking to the wrong person about an appropriate punishment. But it's interesting, the idea that of having sympathy in this question of what's real and what's, like, you know, I don't know what's real for Jesse Smollett.
Yeah, and I think, too, part of the reason we wanted to talk about this, because in some ways it's like the idea of being able to choose your own reality is kind of like the ultimate American dream, right? Like, you get to, like, choose your own adventure, choose your own reality. But I also think it does something, I don't know. I mean, I think it kind of like violates this like human contract that we all have to sort of agree on some sort of moral compass. I mean, you talked me into that in this episode where I was just like, well, anything's possible. We're in the upside down. And then it's like, I kind of come around to being like, no, actually there kind of has to still be a sort of some sort of scale of right and wrong. And if we all can't agree on it, then I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know where that leaves us.
It leaves us expletived, basically. And I don't want to live that way.
I don't want to live that way.
I mean,
either.
I think we. I mean, it's funny though, because I actually think we can all. I want to believe, this is me walking onto that plank again,
mm-hmm.
but I actually want to believe that whatever stuff got dredged up in the last, I would say 10 years, to be honest.
Yeah.
This didn't just start. This started in like 2007. I would say during the primary between the Clintons and Barack Obama.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we don't talk enough about how they basically played Trump's game during that primary. I mean, it's nuts. And so we've been dealing with some version of this, mm-hmm. like this, not so much the reality question, although increasingly mm-hmm. the reality mm-hmm. question. But now we are full blown upside down.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, the ship has to uncapsize itself,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm. Depending on which movie we're in. I mean, to be honest with you, depending on which version of it we're in.
All right. Well, there's 37 people running for the president for Democrat for the Democratic nomination. I think the number went up to 42 today. So, speaking of game shows, I don't want to play.
I know.
We stay also tuned.
We also wanted to make sure there were time for questions from the audience,
yes.
which I was going to transition us to.
I was trying to get back from the plank.
Thank you. No, it's okay. You did good. I was here to really get back in.
So there are two live mics going around the room.
So all you have to do is raise your hand and somebody will come to you.
This question.
You can pretty much ask us anything.
within reason.
Hi.
Oh, hi.
This question is on your right, far right.
Oh, far right.
Our far right.
Hey,
yes.
There.
Hi.
That's how little I want to go far right. Gosh.
This is more of a request, but I'm over here.
Yeah. Oh, that's not that far.
Thanks. I love the show. Been listening a long time since before the election. So, I'd love to hear you talk some time about either RuPaul's Drag Race or.
Oh my God.
This season or what? Like, what are we talking about?
Pick the one.
Because I have lots of fun.
Or Showgirls, 25th anniversary.
Just kidding. Thanks. Okay, sold. Who are you rooting for this season? Listen. Oh, Brooklyn Heights, that's such an easy win. All right. I'm here for Silky Ganache. I'm just ready for that. Love me some Dr. Ganache. Because she's getting her PhD. So, okay, so that was a great request. Thank you. Another question, please.
Showgirls, I support.
Yeah, we would do that. Yeah. We would do that.
This question's from the front of the balcony.
Okay.
Hey.
Hi.
Hi. I'm curious for both of you, was there any moment when your career was starting out that a story you worked on was misrepresented and or in a way that you didn't agree with? And did you speak out against that, even though it might not have been quote unquote professional?
Ooh, that's a good one.
I don't ever do that. I did.
Wait, do what? Speak out?
What you're asking is, have I written something that has been misreceived by a readership?
Or are you asking, have we ever written something that didn't go out the way we intended it?
Oh, that.
You know? Which one is it? Those are two different.
They're kind of the same, aren't they?
I mean, it's one thing if you write a story and then it's received very differently by the readers, or did it get tweaked at some point during the editorial process?
Oh, no, that's
like,
never
that's
happened
what I was wondering. Yeah, that's never happened to me.
If that's
either.
Your question, I've never had that.
Yeah.
Have you?
No.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. I mean, I've
been
at the Times for so long, but I don't think
say.
So.
I've never had it. I've definitely had editors when I was younger try to make me do. I mean, I've only had one type of job my entire life, which is the practice of criticism. And did I make that sound less important or too important or sad? I mean, I cleaned toilets at a movie theater for a long time. So, I mean, I didn't just get handed this job. But I did, actually, when I was here, I had, when I worked at the Chronicle, I had a really hard time adjusting to, I was young, I was, again, petulant, I didn't like losing this woman who edited me, Heidi Benson, and this man who edited me, David Dayton. They were great. I got new editors. I was very upset about that. But I also think that the things I was writing under this new system just made me less happy, and they were less reflective of who I thought I was as a writer. But I couldn't actually, I mean, it did not occur to me to do anything once the pieces went public. I just left
my job.
Yeah,
I think there's a period of time as a younger person, or you're a little greener, where you're kind of given assignments that you maybe don't want to do, or you know, you're kind of just like chalking it up to experience. And I mean, I feel like for me over the course of my career, because I've also had the same job for the majority of my salaried career. I've been just a reporter for the Times, so I know that I became quickly like more protective over my stories. Like I always wanted to mm-hmm. see what photos they were going to put with it. So if we were going to write about, you know, a CEO who also happened to be a woman, I would be like, you know, does it have to be a full body shot? You know, like that kind of thing. Or think a lot about the headlines. Like I always was really protective over the packaging of the stories. But it gets easier to be more confident about that as it goes on.
This
I hope that's helpful.
This question's on your right.
Okay.
Hi, I recently moved out of the Bay Area, and when you guys were talking about your experience here, I wanted to know how you dealt with being one of the only people that look like you in a space that's so progressive like the Bay Area, or how it felt to be at a place like the New York Times as black journalists trying to do a podcast together. How do you deal with being the only, like, in a room, in an audience like this?
That's a really nice question. Oh, God. I mean, for me, it's interesting because, like, covering tech, you know, from I was 24, I was really, really young. And so it was really interesting because early on, like, everybody knew who I was. And at first I was like, I must be good at my job. And then I was like, oh, y'all just can recognize me easily. Like, you know, like, I stand out in the room. But I don't know. I feel like for me, it's always been really important to find your people and keep them really close and make sure you have allies, make sure you have people that you can talk to and help workshop stuff with. And that was always really, really, really important to me. And I think living here, because I moved with friends from college and I had my people and we were POCs, that we were able to kind of insulate and protect each other. And I felt really... that was like my pack when I lived here, for sure. And we did everything together. We, you know, were exploring ourselves and finding ourselves and going to queer clubs and stuff together. But I do think that a lot of my queer identity didn't form here because I didn't really register. I mean, I'd be curious to know how this shaped out for you, but I had a really hard time, like, coding here. Like, I mean, I just feel like people didn't know what to make of me. And so I was either kind of a little bit of like a pretty bird in some sort of glass menagerie, or like I wasn't read as like available or interesting beyond like somebody that people wanted to have at their dinner party, be in their midst. And so I was young enough that I was just sort of like, there's more life to this life. Like, this isn't the end for me. And when I was actually brought out to New York, I was like, oh, a new chapter is starting. And I was really excited to be able to be in a much more diverse city, because I grew up outside of DC. I grew up in an incredibly, you know, diverse neighborhood, and like, it wasn't enough just to know like all the lyrics to Biggie. You know, you had to be able to bachata too. Like, it was, you know, you also had to know like what dim sum was. Like, you had to be fluent in a type of different cultures and ethnic experiences that I never was taught to take for granted. Like, it was really important, a really important part of my upbringing. So I think that kept me really grounded in the sense that I knew that that wasn't the real world. Like, I went to a predominantly white institution for college. I work at a predominantly white institution, but I also was like, this isn't reflective of my personal reality. So having that wherewithal and then making sure I'm taking care of myself and that I feel that I can, you know, figure out who to talk to if I need to see, like, am I getting paid a fair amount? You know, and I was lucky because I had a lot of advocates on my team. And when I was at the New York Times, there was a moment when I was coming in that an editor was like, I don't know what your experience is going to be like here. And I was like, that's not encouraging, you know. And but I was lucky to be on a team of a lot of, you know, basically all white men, but who really looked out for me. And, you know, when I expressed sort of uncertainty, like, hey, am I getting paid a fair amount? Because at a certain point, I wasn't just a blogger, I was like killing it. I was writing front page stories week after week after week, and I was like, hey, you know, some people out here are really experienced, but I'm carrying a very heavy load. An editor pulled me aside and was like, okay, I'll help you. Let me help you figure out if you're getting paid enough. You know, like, people, but I think I had to really, like, you know, I mean, I'm a Scorpio, so maybe it came easier for me, but I had to really find that confidence to be like, like, I have to advocate for myself and I have to stand up for myself because I won't be able to sleep at night if I don't. So that always kind of kept me, you know, on that path.
I mean, here's an anecdote. And it's very short. I go to a lot of New York theater. Period. Okay, I'll keep going. And sometimes, and I'm writing a story about this right now, so it's very, I'm very, very, I mean, I've always been sensitive to my awareness of who's in a room. And I don't know that I've never felt self-conscious about my blackness in relation to whiteness. And when I was here, I found black friends, but it was much less. San Francisco itself, I mean, but even at some point going to Oakland was eye-opening for, like,
oh my God,
the work you had to do in Oakland.
Yeah.
At least when I was here. And I mean, most of the friends I had when I was here were white, and there was rarely a problem among us. But it was sort of really just being in the world. Anyway, the story that I'm working on is just about this amazing thing that's happening in American theater right now, which is this explosion of young black playwrights. And there are more great shows being written by more young black people. In a context of the sort of establishment, the establishmentarian, for lack of a better concept, but like, oh my God, there are black establishmentarian playwrights in this country right now. And they have a radical counterpoint in these young people. And that now you have this spectrum of black theater being conceived and executed in New York. And it is a thrilling experience. And you know, these young playwrights, three of them have had 6 shows produced in less than a year, or a little bit more than a year.
Which is incredible.
But ask me how many of those shows on Broadway. 0.
And who's in the audience?
Well, who's in the audience for all of these shows?
Yeah.
Very few of them are black people. And at some point, the writers of these young writers account for who's in that audience. And the power of these shows is they don't care because they're working through something for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can't handle that, that's your problem. And if you feel uncomfortable, you have to figure out what your discomfort is about.
Mm-hmm.
And that is very different, with all due respect to the people who made To Kill a Mockingbird, way different than the experience of seeing To Kill. Like, in Broadway, like, when you go see a show in New York now, what happens is, before the last word even gets uttered, somebody is like, is it time to stand up? When can I clap for this amazing thing that I don't even know why I'm clapping for, except the ticket was $275. They don't know what to do with these, with Slave Play, or this show called Fairview. Have you guys, this show, Fairview, by this woman, Sybil's Drury, this woman is amazing.
Yeah.
If any of her work is produced in this city and you have not seen it, you should go. She is worth a ticket to New York.
It's coming back soon, too.
And Fairview is going to be put on again in Brooklyn. Anyway, I think about this all the time. I don't overthink it, but frequently.
But it was funny. We went to see this amazing play called Slave Play by a young playwright named Jeremy Harris. You might have seen pieces on him recently. He's definitely on the come up. His show Daddy just closed as well. And there's a twist in the play, but basically you think you're watching one thing and then it flips and you realize you're watching something else. And there's sort of, the twist is very racialized. And all I can say is, in the first half of the play, all the white people were laughing. In the second half of the play, all the black people were laughing. And me and Wesley were cackling. And at one point, these like women turn back and look at us, and we're like, bah! Like they're black too, and we're like, and you know, it's just like this thing though, that's like, it was really interesting to be, you know, in the minority of a population who is in on a joke, and everybody else doesn't really know what the joke is. And it was this like really interesting moment of like, I've never experienced anything like that.
I've never experienced anything like that before.
Yeah, it was really incredible.
You know, I don't know how many weeks later, we all got a little reality check when Green Book won Best Picture. And
I know,
exactly
that's...
It's a bottomless, there's no satisfying answer for this. At a certain point, you just realize as a black person in a certain aspect of the world that there are not going to be that many other black people. This is true whether you're coming to see us, whether you go to see Michelle Obama or Beyonce Jenna.
You don't.
Depends on the city.
If you're but I'm saying it. Okay, Coachella is one thing, but Formation Tour, no. Okay. Like, and you didn't come on that. you didn't come on that tour with me. But you know, it's interesting because I do think that this is sort of a question that I ask myself all the time, which is just like, what is my threshold for suffering? You know, and at what point, like, when am I in a position where I'm not worried about repercussions for advocating for myself or calling something a microaggression when it's a microaggression? It's like, it is exhausting to always have to navigate through these labyrinthine mazes that most people aren't even aware that they're also part of. And so, you know, it is this like kind of ongoing dilemma of just like, I always think about it as like energy conservation. I'm just like, how much energy is this thing gonna get today? Because I only have this much and I got a concert this weekend. You know what I mean? Like, I'm just trying to figure out how to be my best version for myself. Like,
but you know, I mean, I'll just say this and we can move on to the next question. But I also think that this is a thing that you and I talk about. We talked about this when we talked about Michelle Obama's book. I actually understand as what I would classify myself as being, which is a successful black person, how much, like, nobody ever wants to hear this, especially certain black people in my family especially, but they have to hear it because it's true, given what I'm doing versus what my cousins are doing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm lucky. Mm. I mean, I'm good at my job, but my cousins are smart. They went to school. There's a part of me that understands the degree to which I can tell you every point at which on the journey from my growing up in Philadelphia on 66th Avenue to getting to this theater tonight.
Mm-hmm.
And I can tell you at every point the coordinates that are luck.
Mm-hmm.
And the coordinates that are me.
Mm-hmm.
And so much of that journey involves good white people and luck. And it's a crazy thing to think about.
Yeah.
Because this could have happened to somebody else.
That's true. Good black people, too.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
It's
but
true.
But we're talking about the gatekeepers. Linda Nauer.
Yeah.
One of those people. Black people didn't really have, I mean, my mother raised me well, my grandmother, I had a lot of important black people in my life,
mm-hmm.
but in terms of power and gatekeeping, one.
Yeah.
Not a one in my life. So, I mean, I also just know the degree to which it was luck, too.
Mm.
For, I mean, probably for everybody, but for me too. Question.
This last question comes from the balcony all the way to your right.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
So when you were talking about Elizabeth Holmes and then also Jussie Smollett and really kind of speaking to Elizabeth Holmes' kind of origin story. So I spent a lot of time digging into both of these things, being in Silicon Valley and then also being black on the Jussie Smollett side. And one thing that it seemed clear to me was that there is so much, there's a lot of kind of concentration on, you know, Elizabeth Holmes as a person and these motivations as to why, but it felt like Jussie Smollett, it was like, let's just kind of make this very clear, good or bad, was he lying, was he not lying? And in general, as people who are working in the media, do you find that conversations are a little bit more simplistic when it is a minority figure, somebody like Jussie Smollett, versus somebody like, you know, Elizabeth Holmes, where it's like, but how could she do something bad? She's so blonde.
To that I say...
Word.
To that I say 53%, but some of y'all know what I'm talking about. I don't know. I do actually wonder to what degree that people can't fat. Like, I do wonder to some degree how much the dialogue around Elizabeth Holmes is gendered, and people think that, like, a woman's not capable of such deception. Like, I it's not something
Have
I've really
never seen
talked
a screwball
talked
comedy
about.
Or
yeah.
film noir.
I don't know. It's interesting. Like, I think a lot about that. Like, I'm not sure what the answer is. I don't know what that reaction is.
Should we take one more
question? Yeah, maybe we should take one more question.
We'll take one more.
All right, we're going to take one last question toward the front on your left.
I got the question.
Hi. Hey.
Maxwell from Brooklyn.
Hi, Maxwell from Brooklyn.
But I have a question. I've listened to you guys' podcast from the very beginning. I always see topics that happen, you know, throughout the continuum of time. How do you guys pick your topics? Because I'm always thinking, like, something happens, I want to hear Wesley and Jenna talk about this. And then you guys don't talk about it. I'm like, oh, my God.
So how do you pick your topics? Well, we don't always. Oh. But you should tweet at us, or you should email, because I read the emails that come into Still Processing in New York Times. I don't know if you do, but I do. And if you hit us up on social media, we have taken show ideas from listeners before. I love to. It's really fun. But usually, I would say most of the shows come out of some type of text or voice note exchange between the two of us. And sometimes it's something as simple as, like, Wesley being like, Jenna, you have to watch this movie. And I'll be like, I don't want to. And he's like, please watch it. And then I'll watch it, and I'm like, you're a genius, you know? Or, like, we'll be snapping Subway ads. We'll be seeing the same ad over and over again. And we're like, why? Like, what is going on? Why are people obsessed with this thing? And so then we'll want to talk about it.
I also think that we are really good about, at this point, knowing what the show, not so much what the show is, but what the show can do.
Mm.
Right? I feel like one of the things that I've really enjoyed about working with you this year is more than ever is that we can think in terms of umbrellas.
Mm.
And how much fabric can we gather before we start to cut the dress, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
That's not an umbrella, sorry, mix my metaphors. And a lot of that comes out of a constant dialogue that, and even once we feel like we've exhaustively talked through something, once we get into the studio and we've like mapped out the journey that we plan to go on, there's still like all of this room for surprise. And I also think, you know, at the end of the day, we're just like you guys. We just have a show, and the things that are like on your mind or bothering you are also on our mind and bothering us, or like things that excite you are also things that are exciting to us.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is, like, what is the most interesting way we can go about thinking about and talking about those things?
And we do have a lot of help from a really incredible and muscular team of producers who help us kind of filter through like the things that feel like a little too out there or a little too unorganized. You can kind of see sometimes we're all over the place. And so we have a very healthy team of like good producers who will be like, of the 10 things you just mentioned, these two make for a good audio show, you know? So that's helpful.
Anyway, yeah, that's how it works. Jenna Wortham.
Wesley Morris.
It's a pleasure. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys. You good?
I felt the world in the and we